This is the absolute penultimate. That's right, we're talking about The Morning Show, Season 2, Episode 9, in which I really enjoyed myself again. At last! This little recap and review is going to get through the myriad of plots and stories while I share some of my thoughts and opinions while spilling some spoilers. So, how are you feeling about The Morning Show as we near the end of the second season? Let's talk about Season 2, Episode 9, Testimony. Alex finally gets home, collapses on her bed, shoves her statement from Mitch that falsely says they didn't sleep together into her bedside table. And I can't see how she's ever going to need that after this episode, but maybe, just maybe. Bradley wakes up on her couch with Hal sleeping in her bed. He apologises for his outburst last episode. He's pretty open and reflective about it. I wanted to hurt you. I wanted to see you hurt the way you hurt me. I don't really remember what exactly she did to hurt him, other than be a little bit lesbian and then ask him to get out when he was mean about it. Seems reasonable. He says he'll swallow his pride and go to rehab. He'll even allow her to pay for it. How magnanimous. I need to learn how to apologise like this. Alex arrives at the studios with Doug, her agent, and spots a picture of Mitch amongst the small memorial with monster written across it in red lipstick. Do we still feel that he is a monster? More on that later. Alex is there for a meeting with Corey and Stella. Alex and Doug think she is in trouble, and Doug is doubling down. Alex has leave in her contract. UBA employees committed fraud by pretending to be her to access her accounts. And Corey is not really bothered. He assures Alex that they love her, like family, closer than family. They wouldn't pay family $25 million. Alex replies, "I'm giving it back, the money. Coming back here was a big mistake, and I can see that now." And so begins the Levy roller coaster of this episode. She says she will be leaving on the 16th of March, and Corey notes that that's the day before Maggie Brenner's book comes out. "There will be damning information about me in there," she says. "I'm going to be cancelled, Corey, for the things that I did." And I think it's interesting, that phrasing, "for things that I did," as if usually people are cancelled for things they didn't do. And she clarifies the things she did. "I slept with Mitch. He is a sexual predator. Your feminist hero slept with the enemy. Did it on purpose, not coerced, while married, and she doesn't regret it one bit. That's who I am." So, that's one mystery resolved. The Alex and Mitch consent question cleared up almost by accident and with no impact on anything. So, why did the writers drag out the mystery? Or was I just making it more complex than it was? I feel a little bit let down by that reveal, but it's still a great scene. Alex feels changed, presumably by Mitch's death, and Corey fights pretty hard to keep Alex on board. He even uses a pretty convoluted pinball machine metaphor, but he doesn't get Alex to stay. She is out. Then, wait for it, Alex and Bradley speak to each other face to face! I think the last time this happened was at the restaurant in episode 3 or something. Alex comes into Bradley's dressing room and lets her know that she'll be back on Monday. But Bradley won't be there because the F-plot with her brother is taking her to rehab on Monday morning. But guess who's agreed to stand in for her? It's only Laura. So we'll get to see Laura and Alex on air on TMS together. Bradley says that Alex and Bradley should go for a drink together later in the week, but Alex advises that Bradley might want to keep her distance. After such a long wait, this wasn't a scene that set anything on fire, but it was nice to see these two stars coming closer together. As Alex is leaving the studio, Paige Jacobs, formerly Kessler, arrives with a masked Rena to address the crew of TMS. Some familiar COVID elements are starting to creep into the storyline now. Paige says that she is arranging a memorial for someone she hates, but her children have asked her if all of their dad's friends will be there. So she's asking as a mother for anyone who might come to show up. She says she'll show herself out, but en route, she and Alex have a staring competition. I really enjoy Paige, and I feel like we could have had a lot more of her in this show. But it does feel like, with Mitch gone, there won't be much need for her going forward, unless she's a journalist and ends up hosting TMS in season 3. On Monday morning, we see Bradley in her car en route to rehab with Hal, and Alex at the studio. Mia tells Alex that they're putting home studios in their presenters' houses, and Alex doesn't think it's necessary. Before they go on air, Laura checks with Alex that they're both going to be professionals. Alex asks Laura to tee her up for a story that happened this weekend, and I thought we were going to get some powerful off-script, on-air revelations similar to the end of season 1, but nothing, which again felt strange. Is this show just full of red herrings? Everything feels like it holds so much weight. Instead, they did a COVID hand-washing spot. What I really enjoyed about this spot was, one, I assume that this doctor is a famous doctor in America, especially with that name, but we don't know her over here. Two, they improvise making their own song to wash their hands to so they don't have to pay royalties for Happy Birthday. Hell has frozen over, Laura's producer says to Chip as they shine together on screen. A cut reveals that the song lyrics have been scripted on the auto cue the whole time. They are both just really good at their jobs. And this is a tiny detail, but it gave me a lot of pleasure. As I said in the last video, I really enjoy when this show takes place in the TV world in which it was established. This season hasn't had a Las Vegas shooting or a California fires episode. It is much more detached from the world of live TV and presenting the news. We spend far more time off camera and even away from the studio. Backstage, Rena can't get the COVID tests and someone asks why Mia wants them. "Do you watch the news?" Mia responds. Then Bradley leaves her brother with some cash at rehab. Yeah. Alex visits Laura in her dressing room, and I think this is my favourite scene of the episode. I said way back when Laura first introduced the idea of Alex outing her that we'd revisit this tale, and I thought it was going to be twisted to be about something else. But Alex has changed. There's a real beauty to this scene. Alex asks openly, "Why don't you like me? What did I do? All I know is one day we were friends and then the next day you pretended like you didn't even know me." Alex says she thought that she needed time alone and that they weren't that close. "I was friends with your friends. I just know that I had liked you." Laura implies that Alex was friends with her success more than she was friends with her. She says she may not have meant it, but Alex liked to talk. And Alex admits it. "You're right. I did talk about it. Boy, gossip seemed so much less vicious back then," she says. "Well, that's because no one was gossiping about you yet," Laura bites back. This is like a grown-up dynasty fight. Here are two mature and vulnerable women being open and honest about their pain and their damaged relationship. Alex leaves, saying, "I would have really enjoyed being friends with you the last few years. I am sorry I screwed that up." She takes the blame. "Hey," Laura stops her. "I said shit about you too. Everyone is complicated. They aren't friends, but maybe they aren't enemies anymore either." Corey asks Bradley to read Maggie's book, which she has to do alone with a hard copy in the publisher's office, so that she can do a one-to-one sit-down interview with Maggie Brenner. Corey tells Bradley that he knows she'll be fair. And we get some key quotes from Maggie's book. "Hurricane Alex wasn't just the stuff of legend, it was the stuff of campfire horror story. Everybody is flawed, but Levy is damaged." Ooh, Maggie hates Alex, but we already sort of knew that, and I was expecting more of a shocking reveal from the book than just what we've known since the very first episode. Mitch and Alex slept together, yes, we know, but whose side will Bradley be on? Chip suggests to Alex that she shouldn't go to crowded gatherings like the memorial because he's worried about her health. "It's not your job to protect me anymore," she says. And we know their relationship is broken. But then it was similarly broken at the end of season 1. We see the memorial. Paige, Paula, Fred, Jimbo the security guard, some crew from TMS, and Martin Short, the sleazy director from season 1 returns. He gives a drunken eulogy that doesn't go down too well and things wrap up. Alex arrives late. She and Fred cold shoulder each other and she gets a frosty glare from Paige across the room. But Paula waves with enthusiasm. We learn that Alex arranged Paula's flight so she could be there. Alex tells her what she has promised Mitch about helping her career and that she might want to draw on her contacts soon while they still have value. Then Alex addresses the room and Aniston is totally electric. She says, Mitch made unforgivable choices. I went to see Mitch in Italy. I saw him the day he died and I wanted you to know that he was really starting to understand the effects of his actions. He was remorseful. He wanted to do better. He wanted to be better. And I know that's not enough. I wanted him to be remembered for that too. This eloquent speech stands in opposition to Claire screaming at Yanko early in the episode about how Mitch had raped Hannah and how people are now memorialising him. Claire is glad that Mitch is dead and hopes that Fred follows him soon. She says Mitch killed Hannah. This show often feels like it wants to leave decisions up to the viewer, but which characters are given arguments and how they are articulated also matters when reaching those decisions. This argument is given to a character so awful she was written out of most of season 2, and she screams it at her ex-boyfriend in the street, while the counsel for the defence of Mitch Kessler is given to the star of the show and an emotionally charged but controlled delivery at an official memorial. One carries more weight in the episode. I nearly didn't mention the Yanko and Claire scene because it felt so insignificant, and also I really don't like awful Claire. But I realised how these two moments might be better understood when looked at together, especially when really, although I hate to say it, I'm team hashtag awful Claire. Bradley takes on Maggie on air, and it's probably my favourite scene ever of Bradley doing her job on the show. She seems assured and confident. She takes Maggie down, and we're all cheering from the sidelines, because who likes smug Maggie? Bradley asks, I wonder why so much of your book is dedicated to Alex and Mitch Kessler's consensual relationship. There are a myriad of terrible things that Mitch has done that you say in here, and those seem like fair game, but why rope Alex into it? I mean, did you have something personal against Alex Levy? She asks why she didn't print the story of how Alex got Bradley the job on TMS. Maggie counters that Alex did that for herself and not for Bradley. Maggie tells the story of Alex coming to her room out of her mind, begging Maggie not to print it. Bradley turns this around by implying that Brenner is heartless for still printing this when someone is clearly suffering so much they have grown and changed. That Alex risked her career to get the UBA story out, that she scooped Maggie. And she finishes by stating that there's a lot of stories about Alex Levy in this book, but I think that's the old Alex Levy. And I think that people change. I know I'm evolving. I wonder if you are. I want more scenes like this with Bradley. I want to see Reese Witherspoon being able to give this kind of performance. It's that old adage that I always bang on about, show and tell. We're always being told that Bradley is this or that. In this scene, they show us that Bradley is good at her job. And it's really entertaining. And Bradley gets a reward too. She becomes Laura's woman. Just in time for Laura to head off to a ranch in Montana to sit out COVID for 2 or 3 months. Their kissing is interrupted by a man with an envelope. Hal hasn't gone to rehab. So Alex's roller coaster is finally on the up and up until she wakes up and her phone is full of negative tweets. Someone has filmed and leaked Alex at the memorial, and my prediction is that it's Fred. We did see him briefly with his phone during Alex's speech, and he is vindictive enough to do it. Alex is in shock. The up has barely given her one good night's sleep. She sees the time, she twists and trips on a high heel. Then we see her waking up in hospital. And on the phone, Doug tells her she has the COVID. Cue the final episode! Things I've skimmed over in this roundup include most of the Yanko and Claire stuff, but oh yes, Claire is paying for Hannah's family's lawsuit. That feels important. Corey appears on a chat show to promote UBA Plus, but When do you ever see TV executives on TV shows? Felt incredibly random. Chip and Alex's relationship being defo over, and of course, Bradley's family drama. I just can't connect with it still. There hasn't been enough to set it up. But, all told, I thought this was a really fun and entertaining episode that was packed full of great scenes and wonderful, wonderful acting. So, what's going to happen in the final episode? You tell me. I'm going to be putting together a predictions video over the weekend, so keep your eyes peeled, or even better, subscribe and hit that bell. But until then, drop some comments and let's talk telly. Even allow her to pay for it. How magnanimous.